Good morning, and we welcome you to worship here at God's House on October the 9th of 2022 for our virtual service if you're watching on video. For those of you who are here today, welcome. We are glad that you are here. Today will be a communion service, so if you've not already done so, please go and get your communion elements so that you can share with us as they are consecrated and in the sharing of our fellowship.
A call to worship today will come from Psalm 66, 1 through 12. Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give him the glorious praise. Say to God, you are awesome, are your deeds, because you have great power. Your enemies cringe before you. All the earth worships you. They sing to you. They sing praises to your name. Come and see what God has done. He is awesome, and his deeds are among the mortal. He turned the sea into dry land. They passed through river on foot. There we rejoice in him, who rules by his might forever, whose eyes keep watch on all nations. Let the rebellious not exalt themselves. Bless our God, O people. Let the sound of the praise be heard. He who has kept us among the living is not let our feet slip. For you, O God, have tested us. You have tried us, and silver is tried. You brought us into the net. You laid burdens on our backs. You let people ride over our heads. We went through the fire and through the water. Yet you brought us out of a spacious place.
Our opening hymn of praise is Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thou compassions they fail not. As Thou hast been forever.
we gather for worship, let us join together in prayer. Holy God, living Jesus, loving Spirit, we ask that you sanctify our worship and praises to you. Come to us with joy, thanksgivings, and celebration. Speak to us words of life and healing. Empower us for the work you have given us to do. God of all life, for this day of hope, we give you thanks. For your power to overcome evil and death, we praise you. For your grace and mercy and love, we are grateful. For we know our weaknesses, our failures, our busyness, our self-justifications and self-interest, and our comparisons that demean and exclude others. Lord, have mercy on us. Loving God, we pray that you tend and comfort all who grieve and those who suffer injustices. Open our mouths to speak the good news. Make our feet swift to be your messengers of hope and healing. Healing Spirit, in this world of hate and violence, divisions and exploitations, we pray for peace and reconciliation. We know that these come through love, compassion, and humility. Give us hearts of generosity toward one another to believe that change is possible, beginning with us. Open our hearts to being filled with your love. In our times today, we struggle with faith in a culture of fear and a language that's divisive and judgmental. Give us a vision of hope and hearts full of courage to follow Jesus faithfully and be transformed ourselves. Come, Holy Spirit, upon us and raise up new leaders who walk in your ways of truth and righteousness. O God of justice, with mercy, help us to be this change. Living Jesus, show us your way of love in our relationships with one another as we pray for one another in our joys and celebrations and in our sicknesses, grief, suffering, hardships, and all the uncertainties of this earthly life. Lord, hear our prayers and show your compassion through us. Lord of hosts in heaven and earth, we pray for the coming of your realm of peace in all creation. Make us instruments of your peace and send us as your servants to bear and be this peace in our times and places until you come again. Amen. The reading from the Hebrew Scriptures, Jeremiah 29, verses 1 and 4 through 7. These are the words of the letter of the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the remaining elders among the exiles and to the priests, the prophets, and all the people whom Nebuchadnezzar had taken into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and live in them. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Take wives and have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage that they may bear sons and daughters, and you multiply there and do not decrease. But seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare.
Our epistle reading today comes from 2 Timothy 2:8-15. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, a descendant of David, that is my gospel, for which I suffer hardship, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. But the word of God is not chained. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, so that they may also obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is sure. If we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful. He cannot deny himself. Remind them of this and warn them before the Lord that they are to avoid wrangling over words, which does no good, but only ruins those who are listening. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved by him, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly explaining the word of truth. We here at God's House encourage you to be a blessing. Be a blessing in your giving. Be a blessing with your compassion. Be a blessing with your mercy. Be a blessing with your love. And most of all, be a blessing to others so others can see God in you. Today, I'm going to speak to those who are young of heart. When you are young, and for most older people, there comes a point in your life where you feel alone. There comes a point in your life where you feel there's no one who accepts you. There's no one who loves you for who you are. There comes a point in your life where you are lonely. And that makes you one thing. It makes you human. No one wants to be alone. But there are some cases in our lives where you are just alone. It's not going to happen. I want you to do one thing. I want you to stretch your spirit, everything in you, your essence and your being, out to Christ. I want you to go to Christ. I want you to go to Jesus. Jesus is the best friend you will ever have. You have to look for him to see him. A lot of people will tell you, oh, Jesus is not real. You can't find him. Jesus is real. Look for the smiles in others. Look for how the trees move back and forth, especially during this fall moment that we have. Look for the animals. Look for your pets. Look through some of your, look through some of your relatives. Look through even the butterflies that are extremely big. We live in Northport, and for some reason, the butterflies are really big around September and October. Look for those things. And also, if need be, make a joyful noise to God. Sing the glory of his name. Give him glorious praise. Just like how you want praise for the good things you do, Christ wants praise for the good things that he has done for you. Christ gave his life for you, so you have the opportunity of salvation. Give Christ some praise. Give God some praise. Acknowledge the things that have been given to you. Be grateful. Have a grateful spirit. Be good and be kind. And if you take time to notice those things, you will truly find out you are no longer lonely and you will no longer be lonely. God is love. Amen.
Our next hymn is Live Into Hope.
of liberty, the right to speak, the right to be, the right to have, once daily bread, to hear God's word and thus be fed. Live into hope, a captive's freed from chains of fear or want or greed. God has proclaimed our full release to faith and hope and joy and peace.
Our gospel reading today is Luke 17, 11 through 19. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 men with a skin disease approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priest." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? So where are the other 9? Did none of them return to give glory to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." This is the word of the Lord.
Let's join in a moment of prayer, preparing our hearts for hearing the word as we share together. O God of hosts, we give you thanks for this day and for your love for us and your word to us, your presence with us. We ask that your spirit would now speak in our hearts words that we need to hear for our encouragement as we live into hope in these days, in our times and places. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. You know, sometimes the sayings in Scripture are difficult. And this is one of those. Jeremiah says, "Pray for your enemies." These words grate on our egos and our own sense of justice. I have a poster I keep on my bulletin board at home. It says, "I prayed for justice, and then I looked at myself and prayed for mercy." In the midst of our suffering, fears, and uncertainties of life, it's hard to remember that the other people who may be involved in our suffering are also human beings and in need of God's love. Our own needs, our own pain, narrow our vision of God's grace. Jeremiah has told the people of Israel that this defeat and exile is from God, and God is still with them. God is still faithful. When we aim our prayers of anger and hate against others, we miss what God is trying to teach us in our experiences. This is not a story of long ago. It's one we live every day in our own times. What lessons is God teaching us today? Yes, there are consequences for our sins. Bad things start happening. It's foolish to say that this storm or that earthquake is God's particular judgment on a group or place. It's more likely a form of judgment for sin and the consequences of those sins coming upon us and all of those who may happen to be in the line of that destructiveness. God's graciousness in life falls like the rain on everyone, and the consequences of our actions are like a flood that sweep away everything in its path, good and bad alike. Here we see how injustices may fall upon the vulnerable more than those who are culpable. The failures of the water systems in Flint, Michigan, or Jackson, Mississippi, disproportionately affect the poor and people of color. God's judgment for our social sins goes deeper than just these incidents. You see, when social structures are undermined by injustice, the entire system becomes compromised and decays, which eventually affects everyone. And this is what had happened to Israel and Judah, that Jeremiah and the other prophets had warned them about for centuries. When it all collapsed in defeat, at the hands of others, everyone, from the poorest peasant to the king, was captured and either forced into exile or taken as servants. It's the same danger we all face worldwide. When we have exploitative practices that create poverty, unequal access to education and healthcare, abuses of political power, and disregard of our ecological footprints, Jeremiah has foreseen the consequences of these things as God's judgment, but hear him and hear the words of 2 Timothy also. God is present with us in our sufferings. God is still faithful. God is always faithful. Although we may abandon God and harm one another, God keeps on seeking our redemption and healing. This radically changes how we perceive our circumstances. There's another book in the Bible called Jonah. Jonah tried to run from God's call to go to the people of Nineveh a century before. It turns out that he didn't want God to forgive them because he knew that if they repented, that God would. So after he had gone through the city, he went and sat under a gourd plant to see their destruction. When God scolded him for his resentments and his unforgiveness, he bitterly replied this was exactly why he had not wanted to go and prophesy to Nineveh in the first place. We must admit our own egos follow a logic similar to this at times. We want to see our enemies and our adversaries, those who have harmed us, get what they deserve. Have we forgotten our own sins so quickly? Have we not seen the collateral damages we have caused? Have we forgotten the grace of God towards us in forgiveness? But then when we get a bit of relief, are we like those other nine in the story in Luke, running off to our own places of worship, disappearing back into our own normal lives without giving thanks for our salvation and our healing? Too often we are like the people of Israel and Judah and those nine. We take the amazing message of God's love for us, but don't want God to include others who aren't like us. We want privileged status, to be God's beloved and elect, forgetting that we were once outsiders ourselves, even undeserving, rebellious, and sinful. Abraham was a wandering Aramean. Joseph was sold by his brothers, falsely accused by the wife of his master, and jailed without recourse to justice and forgotten by those he had helped. But God was with him. And God's purpose for his time there in Egypt was revealed when his brothers showed up needing food. God used Joseph to save his whole family. Jesus' disciples became apostles of this gospel of God's love, enduring hardships, persecutions, jails, torture, and death. And yet the more they suffered for the word, the faster it spread, despite the empire's efforts to stamp it out. And so God is still working God's purposes out today in all of our wanderings, our struggles, sufferings, and challenges. Paul encourages Timothy and us not to lose our faith and hope when we feel like the exiles in Babylon, or someone who has been shut up in a jail or some sort of other prison, teetering on the same fence of hardships. Some of the people were despairing and giving up on God's promises. They were in danger of abandoning the faith. Others were seething with anger and resentments and praying to God to judge the Babylonians harshly. Both of these ways of thinking miss the truth of God's loving purpose for the salvation of the whole world, not just us. Abraham was called to be a blessing to all the nations. And this includes those we consider our enemies. Our welfare is wrapped up in their welfare. If we seek peace, it must be for everyone, not just us. How can there be peace and healthy social or international relationships if we continue to be stressed by hate, violence, and fear? If the Babylonian captives, who are going to be there for a long time, for generations, seek to undermine Babylon's stability, what peace can they expect for their lives in that place? When people undermine the structures of rule, of peaceful law, what kind of peace could there be in any country? No, we must pray and work for everyone's welfare, including theirs, whoever they are in our minds, especially when they are blind to the consequences of their practices. You see, we are all in this world and this life together. We are on the same ship as humanity that is capable of sinking this one planet on which we depend on for life. We cannot afford to let ourselves become mired in us-them logic that ignores how much of this is about us together. We will find our own welfare improves when we consider the welfare of others, no matter who they or we are. The second letter of Timothy rings with this same message that's twofold. Stay faithful amid your struggles and sufferings, and realize that God is present with you, working out God's good purposes. God's word is true. God is loving, and this word cannot be chained. God seeks and is working out our salvation, especially amid our struggles. How we behave in every circumstance is a living witness to this truth in love. In fact, it was what caused people to realize something was different about these Christians in the Empire of Rome. Paul was imprisoned not for insurrection or some other sin, other than witnessing in an empire that was idolatrous. The injustice and suffering was no shame to him because he was imprisoned based on principles of truth, love, and peacemaking. And it's only served to make the message of God's grace more public and louder the more they tried to oppose him. There is no wall, no lock, no chain, no ban or censorship that can stop it from spreading if we are living it. Living one's faith wherever we are is our calling. If we suffer because of it, that only makes the message more visible and loud. And whoever is considered an outcast is restored to human dignity in Jesus and in Christian community. The Samaritan was a real shocker for folks in his community. The faith and fellowship of people that consider outsiders is one of the greatest witnesses to God's grace. When Jesus healed the 10, it was the acceptance and praise of the grateful Samaritan that shakes the minds of those who were his hearers. See, election theology without humility and gratitude for grace runs off to get what it wants, even from religion. And then that's the last we see of them. It was the outsider's faith that showed them up and exposed the shallow use of religion as privilege. Those who are humble and grateful recognize God's loving presence with them. Stop then and there and give thanks, and take time to worship wherever they experience it. One of the most embarrassing moments for exiles was when their captors demanded they sing the songs of Zion while being a defeated people sitting by the rivers of Babylon. How could they speak of God as the mighty creator and the shepherd who guarded them day and night when their nation had been conquered and they were in this condition? Christians faced the same taunts in the Roman Empire. How do you witness to your faith in a loving God in the face of jails, lions, brutal beatings, and crosses? Such suffering is not always for your own sins. It's the sins of others that affect us. In Paul's day, there was, at the time of this writing, there was no longer a temple to run off to. There was only the inner peace and trust in God that remained, no matter what happens to us, that we cannot be separated from God's loving care for us. So he urges Timothy and believers everywhere not to be complacent in our worship and faithfulness, to persevere in humility, love, and gratitude to God. You see, the most powerful witness of faith is not in the good times, but in the hard times, when it costs us something to be different from the world. And Jesus speaks of our interconnectedness with one another. What you do to one of the least of these, you do to me. This applies to our faith community, yes, but also to our families, our schools, our workplaces, our cities, our nation, and the world. We are interdependent as human beings. And in social systems and ecosystems with diversity and balances of life, and what we do affects everyone else. As Dr. King put it, injustice anywhere is injustice everywhere. We are called instead to be mindful of one another, compassionate, mutually respectful, generous, and kind, no matter what our circumstances. We are to seek the welfare of all who are where we are. This is the unchained gospel of God's love and grace, proclaimed in our words and deeds, faithfully just like Joseph's, not just in our worship sanctuaries once a week, or however we happen to show up there, but at all times, in every context. When one member hurts, everyone hurts, because we are part of the one body of Christ. And the truth is that such love and regard for one another not only builds unity for our ministry together, but it also is something that is envied by those who live by the rules of the dog-eat-dog world. They want us to fail to justify their rejection of the ways of God. They make life difficult for us, trying to defeat us. They look for any flaw or failure in our faithfulness and gleefully point them out to others. Even so, the word of God at work in us does not fail. Even if we fail to be faithful, God is faithful. Thus, in all things, God is present and loving. And as this love is manifest through our lives, through our resilience in the face of suffering and our gratitude for God's grace, the gospel of God's love for all people is truly unchained. The forces of sin and evil cannot stop this good word or the love of Jesus from spreading and healing the whole world. Let us join together in our hymn of response. God, whose giving knows no ending.
God, whose giving knows no ending, from your rich and endless store, nature's wonder, Jesus' wisdom, costly cross. Strive for self-love.
your throne. Treasure to you have been trusted. Gained through powers your grace conferred. Eyes to use for home and kindred. And to spread the gospel word. Open wide our hands and share. Healing, teaching, and reclaiming, serving you by loving all.
So we now join in sharing in this table which Jesus gave to us to remind us of the power of his love to overcome all evil and human divisions, even the power of death, and to unite us with him. He instructed us to share it in the unity of the Spirit with love for one another as he has loved us. Let us join together in the prayer that he taught his disciples to pray. Our loving parent, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. This table pronounces the accomplishment of God's promised redemption in love. As you have confessed your sins and turned to the grace of God in Jesus Christ, they are forgiven. God is with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to God.
It is right to give God thanks.
It is right
to give God thanks and praise. Let us pray. Yes, O God, you created all that is with your word, and your love calls all creation to unite to bring forth life and to glorify you. We look to the word that became flesh for our redemption and reconciliation through your grace. Your love is for all who turn to you in faith and hope. We give thanks that there is nothing that can change this good news of life in Jesus Christ. We listen for your Spirit to speak, to guide, to help, and to strengthen us in faith until all of your purposes are fulfilled and established forever to your glory. We join the hosts of heaven and all creation, praising and glorifying you as the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer of all life, saying together, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of our God. Hosanna in the highest. Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks for it, he broke it. And he said, This is my body, which is given for you. Take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after the meal, he took the cup. And he blessed it. And he said to his disciples, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. As often as you drink it, remember me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim my death and resurrection until I come again. Let us pray. God of hosts, creator of the universe, you have given us grain of the field and fruit of the vine to sustain our bodies. And Jesus took these elements and set them apart for this sacred and holy sacrament to sustain our spirits in community and in unity of the Spirit. Bless them as holy and set them apart for this sacred use as each of us understands your grace and love for us. Amen. Let us say together the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come and share the feast. Take and eat. This is the body of Christ, which is given for you. Let us pray. God of power and grace, we give you thanks for life, for your power to heal and to sustain our lives. We give you thanks for the love you show us in Jesus Christ. And we give you thanks for your presence with us always, as your Spirit dwells with us in its reconciling work, uniting us in love. We give you thanks for this table and this community as it nurtures us and enriches us by our diversity. We give you thanks for this witness to the resurrection and its power to turn us toward you in trust, even in the most difficult times and circumstances, that no matter what may happen in life, we are forever safe in your care. Amen. Live as children of the light and walk together in unity as God's beloved people in the love of Jesus. The Spirit of God has been poured out upon you, and it will strengthen and sustain you, guide you, and keep you until Christ comes again in glory. Amen. God is with you.
And also with you.
Amen.